its variability. Solution.
Thank you. So I'm going back to the basics after all the sophisticated science we've been listening to. Going to try and understand what is the system responsible for the monsoon. Since not everybody here is familiar with the monsoon, I thought I would introduce it. In India, the word monsoon in common parlance refers to the system that visits the continent every year and gives us rain. The commencement of the rainy season is associated with the onset of the monsoon and end of the rainy season with the retreat of the monsoon. Now, what is the rainy season? If we look at the country as a whole, and this is all India average rainfall, then you see that in fact most of the rain occurs from June to September, and this is the summer monsoon period. I will only talk about the summer monsoon rainfall, that is June to September rain. Now, there are many definitions of the monsoon, the most popular being the one emanating from Arab sailors who first used the word monsoon, and it is the seasonal variation in the direction of winds. And the classical definition of monsoonal regions is based on seasonal variation in the direction of winds. But as Sikasav said yesterday, we over the land don't care about winds, we care only about rain. And in fact, monsoon is also defined as seasonal variation of rainfall, wet summers and dry winters. Now, to us, seasonal variation of rainfall is far more important than winds. But this is the seasonal variation of winds. We have a monsoon trough here. Again, this was mentioned yesterday in the summer. And the winds are from the southwest. During October, November, December, the winds are from the northeast. This is when Krish wanted to increase the rainfall here by building mountains on mountains. And so this is the so-called southwest monsoon and northeast monsoon, which you will realize are big misnomers, but I'll come to that later. So these are the monsoonal regions of the world defined by seasonal variation of rainfall and of wind. And you can see Indian region is right at the center. Now, what is the mean monsoon? So this is the mean monsoon rainfall pattern. What you see here is a rain belt in which the rain is decreasing as you go northwestward. This is along the monsoon trough that you saw in the earlier slide. Here, we believe orography also has a lot to do with rain. So we are concerned with the large-scale rainfall over the monsoon region, which is the monsoon zone rainfall, basically. So as I said, the mean rainfall pattern has a major rain belt here, and in addition, there is orographic rain as well. Now, we are interested in the variation of the monsoon, and this is the variation from 1876 to 2009 of the All India summer monsoon rainfall. So this is averaged over the country and averaged over June to September. Now, 10% of the mean is roughly one standard deviation. So deficit more than 10% are droughts, and excess more than 10% are excess rainfall seasons, and those are in green, droughts are in red. I will not have time to talk about it, but this shows very interesting clustering of droughts in certain epochs. And we thought that when we didn't have a drought in this period from 87 to 2001, we were in one of these good epochs. But unfortunately, 2002 was a major drought, and that was followed by 2004 and 2009. So I don't know where we are. Okay. So that was the interannual variation. Interseasonal variation on the all India scale, this is the daily rainfall averaged all over India, and you see that there are relatively weak spells and active spells. These are drought years in which we had very long intense breaks, and these are normal monsoon years, but note that even in normal monsoon years, there are fluctuations between active weak spells. So it's part of the, this is over central India. And this is, this shows it more clearly. This is the 72 drought year, and these are the active spells. Notice that the active spells in the poor monsoon years are not all that different from those in good monsoon year. Many times, the difference is in the dry spells that occur. Okay, so now what I'm going to try and talk to you about today is what is the system responsible for the monsoon? As you heard yesterday, you know, monsoon has been studied for more than three centuries. There are two kinds of hypotheses put forth for the system which is responsible for the monsoon. The first in 1686, due to Halley, attributes the monsoon to a system special to a monsoonal region. Okay? And the second hypothesis, on the other hand, attributes the monsoon to a larger amplitude seasonal response of a system which is also present over non-monsoonal regions. So there is a difference in the nature of these two hypotheses. The first hypothesis was, as I said, proposed in 1686 by Edmund Halley, better known for the comet, and he published this paper in the Philosophical Transactions of Royal Met Society, historical account of trade winds and monsoons observable in the seas and near the tropics, with an attempt to assign the physical cause of the said winds. And the major point he made in this paper was that he suggested that the primary cause of the monsoon was the differential heating between ocean and land. And this is what we have been taught from school, college and so on, that the primary cause of the monsoon, the primary driver, is the differential heating between ocean and land. Now, differential heating, according to Halley, would cause pressure differences in the atmosphere, winds blowing from the high pressure to the low pressure, and so on. Halley and many scientists after him considered the monsoon basically to be a gigantic land-sea breeze, in which the ascent of air, and hence clouds and rainfall over the heated land, is generated by the land-ocean temperature contrast. Now, of course, Halley's was a very simple theory, non-rotating fluids and so on. In 1735, Halley modified it to incorporate Coriolis force, which is necessary. So the zeroth order model that Halley had is basically something that we think of as Baynard convection. You have contrast, this part is hot, this part is not hot, cold, and so you have ascending air over the heated region, and depending on the Rayleigh number, you know, the ascending zone is either broad or narrow. So this was the zeroth order model, if you wish, of the monsoon. Now, to this, of course, one added Coriolis force, and that would only change the direction of the winds. But the vertical circulation in the meridional vertical plane was envisaged to be a simply Rayleigh kind of, Baynard kind of circulation. Now, this has some implications for variability, because if the main driver of the monsoon is the land-ocean contrast, then you expect that ascent of air and therefore rainfall will increase with increasing land-ocean contrast, right? And that is still believed by several scientists even today. However, as was pointed out in 1921 by Simpson, observations of the space-time variations of the monsoon over the Indian region are not consistent with this expectation. He put it very lucidly, Simpson. He says, "I believe very few educated people would have any difficulties in giving an answer to the question, what is the cause of the monsoon? They would refer to the high temperature over the land compared with that over the surrounding seas, would speak of ascending currents of air causing an indraft of sea air towards the interior of the country. It is only when one points out that India is much hotter in May before the monsoon sets in than in July when it is at its height, or draws attention to the fact that the hottest part of India, the northwest, gets no rain at all during the monsoon." And this is just to remind you of what he is talking about. This is the surface pressure map, and this is a low pressure here. This is the temperature for July. Sorry for the quality of the slide, it's from Y.P. Rao's book. And you see, this is the hottest part of India, northwest. And what I've shown here is the July rainfall, and you can see the hottest part of India gets no rainfall during the monsoon. Okay? Or shows by statistics that average temperature is much greater in years of bad rains than in years of good rains, that they begin to doubt whether they know the real cause of the monsoon. Such statistics that Simpson didn't actually give the statistics, but that was generated by Kothavle and Roop Kumar in 2002. What they did was look at the land surface temperatures, land temperatures at various levels actually, for drought seasons and excess monsoon seasons, and what they found was the following. So these are monthly temperature anomalies. Now this is at the surface, this is at 700, this is a higher level, 200. And this is the summer monsoon season. Solid are deficit monsoon or droughts, and hashed are excess. And you can see month by month, in droughts the temperature is higher at the surface and also for the season as a whole. Whereas in excess rainfall season, India is cooler. Okay, this is something we those of us who live in India know very well. Now, as expected, at 700 millibar, the situation changes. That's because the cloud heating is less. So at 700 millibar, in fact, the droughts have colder temperatures. So this is now well established. And as I said, this is consistent with our experience in the rainy season, that days without rain are hotter than rainy days. So clearly, rather than the land surface temperature determining the amount of rainfall, via the impact on the difference between land and ocean temperature, the land temperature is determined by the rainfall or lack thereof. So land-ocean temperature contrast cannot be considered as a prime driver of the monsoon. So observations suggest that the land surface temperature varies in response to the variation in rainfall, and it is not appropriate to consider land-ocean temperature contrast as a cause of the monsoon rain. In other words, observations are not consistent with this gigantic land-sea breeze hypothesis of the monsoon. Now, several scientists to this day consider the differential heating between land and ocean to be the primary cause of the monsoon. For example, elementary monsoon by Webster, which is quoted by several people. This is in the book on monsoons in 87. Then Meal talks of effect of tropical topography on global climate, and I will mention what these people say. It is also textbook material. Okay, it has gone in several textbooks that this is the main thing. So what is the view of the modern scientists who follow this land-sea breeze hypothesis? So Webster considers the zeroth order model of the monsoon to be a response to the differential heating associated with land-ocean temperature contrast. But then he adds also the effects of moisture and rotation. So his zeroth order model then very quickly is when you have continuous differential heating, the final circulation will just involve rising over land, sinking over ocean, and a cell of this kind. Now, when he includes effect of rotation, of course, this is high pressure over sea, low pressure over land, and in response to this kind of a pressure gradient, you will get westerlies here and easterlies aloft and so on. This is the impact of rotation. When he puts in what he calls moist moisture monsoon, still the physics is the same. Over this low pressure region where ascent is caused basically by land-ocean temperature contrast, you now get clouds. So this is Webster's model of the monsoon. Again, it's a land-sea breeze with moisture included and taking rotation of the earth into account. Now, Meal added another important factor, namely topography. And we know we have a very spectacular topography in Tibetan Plateau. So what he says is that tropical topography can intensify the solar heating over land by providing an elevated heat source. This magnifies the regional scale land-sea temperature contrast and facilitates the onset and maintenance of monsoon regimes that can produce convective rainfall and heating. So same basic idea. This is the solar radiation and land. Land heats faster than ocean. And here he has topography, so he has an elevated heat source, and so you get more rain. But the zeroth order model remains the same. Now, it intrigued me. Why was it that Simpson's valid criticism was ignored for so long? Because Simpson criticized it in 1921. And I think it is perhaps because this was a comment in a paper in which he proposed an alternative hypothesis, which is a little preposterous, okay? And which probably was not accepted by most people. What he suggested was the following. He said these mountain ranges around India, the ones marked in red, essentially form two sides of a box in which air is coming in from the other two sides. Okay? So he says that we have two sides of a box which are closed, into which an air stream streams through the other two sides, and there are no openings on the other sides at low level. So according to him, the heavy rain is caused by the inflow of large quantities of damp, warm air into a region where, on account of the peculiar distribution of mountain ranges, it is forced to ascend and in consequence deposit its moisture as rain. So he has an alternative theory. The actual temperature over Indian land is not directly responsible for the axial currents, he re-emphasizes, which cause the rain. On the contrary, in the regions where the rainfall is prevented, the temperature is abnormally high, while the greatest rainfall is accompanied by low temperatures. So he emphasizes that it's not land temperature that is driving it, But his theory, as you will agree, is somewhat peculiar because it assumes the winds will be as they are, you know, as if they are independently determined. So I don't want to dwell on that. In any event, Simpson's valid criticism of the land-sea breeze model for the monsoon appears to have been ignored by almost all the scientists. So not surprisingly, even to this day, in several papers, and I'll just give one example of a paper written by Ramanathan et al. On impact of aerosols, in which they talk about land-ocean contrast decreasing because of aerosols and immediately conclude that that will have an impact on the Indian monsoon. So this has been a problem. Now what is the alternative hypothesis? According to the second hypothesis, the monsoon is a manifestation of the seasonal variation of the tropical circulation in response to the seasonal variation of the solar radiation. Of course, the fact that we have a piece of land here with topography makes a difference to this response. But it is basically, monsoon is basically attributed to the seasonal migration of the ITCG, Intertropical Convergence Zone a la Charney, or what Reel calls the equatorial trough, or what Ramage calls the near equatorial trough, which is the rising limb of the Hadley cell onto the monsoonal region in the summer. I believe this was Charney and Reel's perception of the monsoon since about the 70s. Although I have not seen it written so in so many papers, but this is what I surmise. So this is the idealized picture of a Hadley cell, and this is the ascending zone, and this is called, on the trough is the intertropical convergence zone, because in the Hadley cell, the convergence is from two hemispheres, it is indeed intertropical. So this is also referred to as the ITCG. So this is an idealized version, if you wish, of a system that comes over us during the summer because of the seasonal response. Now, in 87 itself, and before, there have been very serious objections raised to attributing the monsoon to seasonal migration of the ITCG. And this point was brought out yesterday by J.S. and Rajivan as well. If you look at the OLR climatology, then you find that in January, for example, these are typical ITCG regions, and the latitudinal extent of the low OLR region is rather small. But you come to July, and it is extending all the way from 10 south to 30 north, 40 degrees of latitude. So just by the looks of it, this system looks different. And this is what Murakami said, that over the Indian Ocean, a persistent belt-shaped distribution of low IR values can be seen mainly during the winter season along the area connecting northern Madagascar and Sumatra. The lack of a similar distribution during the summer, June to August, indicates that the ITCG over the Indian Ocean changes its existence drastically from winter to summer. So people were not willing to buy this notion that maybe it is the same animal that is giving us rain over the monsoonal region. And you see this manifested in many writing. For example, in the depiction by Webster, same book, Variable and Interactive Monsoon, he has shown these are the winds and these are the different regions. M is the monsoonal region here and African monsoon here. And he denotes the regions where ITCG dominates by C. So this is the East Pacific ITCG. So monsoonal regions, this is the Australian monsoon, this is the South African monsoon. So monsoonal regions are conceived as being somewhat different from the regions whose dynamics is controlled by the ITCG. And as I mentioned, this remains today. Now it appears that even Reel, who had probably the greatest insight in tropical meteorology besides Charney, got convinced that the basic system over the monsoonal region was indeed his equatorial trough between 54 and 79, because he wrote two books. 54 book. This is the depiction of the zonally averaged equatorial trough for July and January. Okay? This is in the 54 book. And what you see is these are the Indian longitudes, Asian longitudes, 80 to 120. There is a gap there. Okay? No equatorial trough is shown. Go to his book in 79. Climate and Weather in the Tropics, and he has connected it. Well, what has happened is, 70s were a very active area with Charney coming out with his CISC and theory of ITCG and so on, and I think Reel also began to see that perhaps the system was the same. Okay, Now, actually, Charlie came to India in 77. And we discussed various things, and I talked to him about some work Sikka and I did, which showed how cyclonic vorticity changed with the rainfall and so on, you know, close to Charlie's ideas then. And he said, you ought to be looking at satellite imagery. And that was an amazing hint, because then Sikka and I sat and did a study of the daily satellite imagery over the Indian longitudes. As well, we also looked at the variation of the 700 millibar trough, which is an important feature of the monsoon circulation, which is associated with moist convection and rainfall. So besides the satellite, this was the one that we did. And what we showed was the following. Firstly, in terms of looks. In satellite imagery, the cloud band over the Indian region during the summer monsoon looks exactly like the canonical ITCG. Okay, this is the ITCG that was in our paper on a specific active day of monsoon, 8 July 73. And this is the ITCG from Reel's book, East Pacific. And this is the ITCG over Equatorial Indian Ocean in March. You can see that to the naked eye, the systems look very similar, zonal band stretching across, very bright with deep clouds. Okay? And in fact, I'm not sure you'll be able to make it out, but India is here, and this is the band you saw earlier, and you can see the same band stretching across all the way almost to North America, to American coast. So sometimes the band over India is a part of the planetary scale band also. So this is an important thing to know. So now looks are okay, but we have to go deeper than that. What were the major characteristics of the ITCG as spelt out by Charney? Intense convergence in the boundary layer, which in rotating systems is associated with cyclonic vorticity above the boundary layer, deep convection and heavy precipitation. These are considered to be important attributes of the ITCG by Charney. Now, we have to be a little cautious in talking about 850 millibar vorticity, because while cyclonic vorticity at 850 millibar is a necessary condition for organized convection, it is not a sufficient condition. Okay? It can also be associated with a heat low or a trough. And so we have to talk a little bit about heat lows and troughs. Heat lows and troughs are characterized by shallow overturning cell with ascent from the surface restricted to the lower 2 kilometers or so, and fair weather with no rainfall. So you remember this was the surface trough that we saw earlier. This is in fact a heat low, the one that that has no rain at all. And we believe this part of the trough is a dynamical low. So at 850 millibar, you see that the low appears still. So if you went only by 850 millibar cyclonic vorticity, you wouldn't be able to distinguish between the trough which is associated with moist convection and rainfall and heat low. So it is necessary to go above the 850 millibar. Now, an analysis which brings out rather nicely the different patterns of overturning associated with the surface trough in the tropics is given by this paper by Trenberth et al. What they did was an CEOF analysis of divergent circulations using both ENSEPRI analysis and ERA. And what they found were there were two dominant modes. The first mode explaining 60% of the variance, and this is the height in pressure. This is the convergence. Okay? So you have convergence over mid-troposphere and divergence aloft. This is the deep mode that people were talking about, the deep convection. On the other hand, the second mode, 20%, you see what's happening there? You have convergence restricted to below 3 kilometers, divergence aloft. Okay? This is a heat low or a heat trough. And this would be associated with fair weather cumulus. Or I don't know if Krish's army would fall into this. But, okay, so now when we look at 700 millibar, if we look at the 700 millibar trough, remember at 850, the trough was still over the heat low region. But if we look at the 700 millibar trough, that coincides in the mean with the rainfall maximum. Non-orographic rainfall, this is all orographic. So the major rain belt that we are interested in, 700 millibar trough is a good tracer of that rain belt on a day-to-day basis. And this was known to Indian meteorologists before our study. If you see with the ERA analysis then, this is the vertical velocity at 850 HPA And of course there is rising over heat low. But if you go to 700, then you get a hole over the heat low. And the belt of rising motion coincides with the rainfall. Okay? So what SG did was to look at two things. One was daily variation of what we called maximum cloud zone. I think Sadler is the one who coined this term. At 70, 80 and 90. So this is the same old picture again. Just to show you the longitudes, this is 70 degrees, 80 degrees and 90 degrees. And what we did was look at these images, and we had only hemispheric images to look at. So we did not go south of the equator in that study. What we noted at every longitude was what is the northern limit of this band, what is the southern limit of this band, and judging what is the axis of this band. Entirely done subjectively by looking at satellite imagery of this kind. MCZ is taken to be that cloud band which has the maximum brightness, which is predominantly zonal, and has a longitudinal extent of at least 10 degrees, which was seen previously. And daily values of these limits were taken for April to October, 73 to 77, 5 years. In addition to that, latitudinal position of 700 millibar trough at these longitudes was obtained from the weather charts, which we looked at. And as I said before, 700 millibar level was chosen so that the heat trough at lower levels was not included. You know, we were actually tracing the moist convective thing. So what are the important results that emerged from this study? Firstly, during June to September, there are two favorable locations for the cloud bands. One near over the heated subcontinent and another over the warm waters of the equatorial Indian Ocean. And this is again the frequency of occurrence of that MCZ shown from April to October. Let us look at July, August, and what you see, this is over India and this is over the bay, 80 degrees and 90 degrees. What you see is two modes are there. Okay, this is well spread out and there is a secondary zone here. As I said, it is actually extending to the southern hemisphere as well, but our data didn't permit us to see that. But there is a sort of no man's zone in between. So we defined the equatorial MCZ as the one south of this and the northern MCZ as the one north of this, taking a limit somewhere in this low frequency zone. Okay, so there are two zones, two MCZs, distinct ones, and this is the way the seasonal migration occurs. This is the location of the axis and this is the standard deviation. One is at 80, one is at 90. So what you see is a seasonal migration of the axis of the cloud band, and it goes all the way from equatorial region to north of 20 and then retreats southward. This is the migration of the MCZ, and you see throughout the monsoon season a band persists over the equatorial Indian Ocean. So there are two modes occurring. In addition to that, the most important feature of the daily thing was these northward propagations. And this is again from the original paper. What it has is the northern limit, the southern limit and the axis. And in addition, it also has the 700 millibar trough. I don't expect you to see all that, but you will certainly notice what is the most prominent feature. These northward movements of the band from the equatorial ITC, which occur year after year. This is the onset movement, but once the monsoon is established, the northward movement doesn't stop. Again, the ITC, the MCZ appears in the equatorial region, again it moves north, again it appears, again it moves north. So the interval is between 2 to 6 weeks, you know. You could say this is also the Madden-Julian, because often it is between 30 to 50 days, the same time scale. But there is a lot of variation from year to year. And so this was a feature which was not known before. It was discovered in this study that we have these propagations from the oceanic region to the... Now, these propagations are also seen in the daily variation of the 700 millibar trough. And there is a high correlation between axis of the MCZ and 700 millibar trough. Okay? So we wanted to make sure that what we were seeing is not just cloud bands moving, but the rain belts moving as well. Okay? Now, I must mention that the typical rate of northward propagation is about 1 degree per day. So it's close to your Madden-Julian. I think 1 degree per day comes to be about 1 meter per second. Slower. Of the same order.
A lot slower.
Well,
5 meters a second.
1 meter, same order of magnitude.
Oh, okay.
You see, 1 meter is an average.
Okay.
You know, often they first go faster, then hang around for a while, and then go faster.
No, I agree.
So for our kind of thing, I think it's close enough. Anyway. Okay. So this is the same picture. You see that the propagations are coherent across the Indian longitude, 70, 80, 90. You see a great deal of coherence suggesting that the whole band is propagating. Okay. And because what you saw earlier was only over Bay of Bengal, and you get propagations whether it is a drought year like 74 or a good monsoon year like 75. They occur year after year. So it's a basic feature of the monsoon. Now what happened in 2012, I don't know if Bhatt is going to talk about it, but we had a whole observational experiment planned to study northward propagation. Two ships were there, one over the bay, one towards the 10 north and one towards 20 north, Bhatt being in the 20 north ship. And although every year almost, we do get a propagation beginning in the last week of July and in 1st of August. This year, there was no propagation. This is July and this is August. No propagation at all from beginning of July to, and the ships came back without catching the propagation. But this is the only year that I know of since the satellite era in which it has happened. But this is life. Okay, so what we showed was that the MCG is associated with an active monsoon day with a cloud band which resembles the canonical ITCG. The MCG over the Indian region is associated with cyclonic vorticity at 850 and 700 HPA, Chinese criteria. Also, there is a high correlation between the axis of MCG and that of the 700 millibar trough, which is known to be associated with intense convergence in the lower troposphere and maximum non-orographic rainfall. These were things known to meteorologists before. So now, what we concluded in 1980 was, putting all this together, it becomes clear that the organized moist convection associated with the monsoon may be attributed to a continental ITCG over the region. This surmise is consistent with the characteristic of an ITCG, that is, presence of a prominently zonally oriented region of moist convection in the tropics associated with high cyclonic relative vorticity and convergence. So, monsoon MCG could be considered as a manifestation of a continental ITCG and the secondary MCG as an oceanic ITCG. This is what we concluded. Obviously, the convergence in both of them cannot be intertropical. So, we use instead the word the tropical convergence zone, which has the dynamical characteristics. Okay? So, we now use the word TCG. And in fact, we have a major program on the continental CTCG program under the Indian Climate Research Program to study the CTCG, because that is what holds the key for the monsoon variability. Now, if the monsoon is indeed associated with a CTCG over the Indian region, as we suggest, why does the mean July OLR pattern indicate a low OLR region of a much larger latitudinal extent? This is the mean July pattern. This is the January pattern. You remember this was Murakami's objection. This is because of two special features of these cloud bands over our region, and these are on the intra-seasonal scale. One is the presence of two TCGs, oceanic as well as continental, which on occasion appear simultaneously. And the other is these northward propagations, you know, which smear out the thing. So you have the intra-seasonal variation in this region is so special that it has a major impact also on the monthly and seasonal variation. See, that it is reflected also in the monthly and seasonal variation. So Murakami was right to raise the objection, but I think we know why it occurs. So what I would like to again emphasize is that, of course, we know that MCG is associated with 850 millibar, 700 millibar moist convection and rainfall. So this is the cyclonic vorticity. Now this is Sikka's paper in 77 for the same day on which this band appeared. This is the 850 millibar, 700 millibar, 500 millibar, 300 millibar. You see these vortices. And the thing is vertical note on an active day. So that it is classical ITCG, if you wish, that when the system is intense enough, it is vertical. Okay, so these are the vortices embedded in it. Now another case, 7th August 2007, again you see synoptic scale embedded in it. So large part of the vorticity of the monsoon zone is often with synoptic scale disturbances. And in fact, generally we find synoptic scale disturbances are embedded in the TCC, and within the synoptic scale disturbances there are also mesoscale disturbances. So it is a multi-scale problem, and this monsoon, for some reason that I cannot fathom, on several days we saw mesoscale systems like this, all by themselves, and they gave intense rain over that region. And somehow they contributed to making the rainfall, thanks, they contributed to making the rainfall reasonable, you know, come to 8% rather than over 10%. But the rainfall characteristics were very different, heavy rainfall, flooding and so on. So I was just wondering, you know, for all of you who think so much about clouds, you remember Reel had made a remark long ago that if the purpose is to transport energy vertically upward, one could either do it by having an ITCZ band around the equator, or you could replace the ITCZ by several hurricanes. And being really even calculated, how many hurricanes would do the same thing? And so there is a distribution, it seems to me, of, the cloud system organization over these now three spatial scales, the planetary scale, the synoptic scale, and mesoscale. And that distribution is not static. It seems to vary from year to year. And what made the mesoscale prominent this year, if indeed it is, I don't have quantitative data to show it, it would be very interesting to answer that. Okay.
So doesn't the Eastern Pacific ITCZ automatically have these three scales very prominently? Sometimes it's very passive, sometimes it breaks up.
Oh, does it have?
Hurricanes.
Does it have?
Yes.
See, that's what I'm saying.
Yes.
Okay, which brings me to the next point.
Because the Eastern Pacific, I think, has the...
In fact, yeah, I'm glad you said it. So now, no, but he's saying, yes. See, that's what we are saying. The animal is the same. It may have come on land. Okay. So now, what are the major issues that we have to think about? First of all, why are there two TCZs over the Indian region? This is not seen over African region, okay? Now, Indian region has a very special geography. We have a very warm equatorial ocean south of our region. So it's a multiple equilibria situation. We could have a TCZ over the heated continent. We could have one over ocean. And nature chooses a combination of two. However, a solution with only the oceanic TCZ and a heat flow kind all over India is a perfectly valid solution of the equations. And in fact, some models to this day simulate that. If you looked at the UK Met and Meteor France models, they in fact have an equatorial ITC. Many models have had this problem because it's more difficult for them to simulate multiple equilibria, you know, with fluctuation between the two. They just get locked onto one equilibrium or another. And unfortunately, none of the modelers can tell you how the models switch from one to another because they change n factors at the same time. Okay, so this is an interesting thing. And how come the moist solution is chosen over India? Is there a role of moist preconditioning? You know, lot of rain occurs in the pre-monsoon. Had that not occurred, would the TCZ have been able to move there and so on? What about the role of the Tibetan Plateau? Oh, I'm sorry. What did I do? I went to the end. Sorry about this. Okay. So what we showed that equatorial ITC plays a very important role in maintaining the CTCZ through those poleward propagations, right? But it's not all positive. The interaction is not all positive. It's a very complex interaction because two TCZs on the same longitudinal belt compete with each other also. One can suppress the other through its descent, okay? And that also we showed that active spells of one coincide generally with weak spells of the other. So it's a very, very complex relationship. You saw a manifestation of that in Ravi's talk in terms of Equino, you know, the relationship between East Equatorial Indian Ocean convection and this, and so on. Okay. And also in break monsoon, I think Rajivan showed how the East Equatorial Indian Ocean flares up. So this competition is seen. Now the whole point of this is, okay, if you believe me so far, that the system that gives us rain is a tropical convergence zone of the garden variety, then we can propose theories for variability of this. Processes that lead to variation of an oceanic ITC will also be here. You know, basic processes like cloud heating of mid-troposphere leading to a decrease in cape and so on, like Krishnamurti and Balme suggested. In addition, there will be processes special to CTCG, like land surface processes. So we have a lot more things to play about with for the variability. But I think one of the major things to understand, which will be probably more appropriate for this audience, is the interaction of these TCGs. So you have a continental TCG, you have an equatorial TCG. Now our CTCG actually is continental only over us. It extends all the way to West Pacific. So there are interactions within the system between West Pacific and Indian region. And of course there is the most famous interaction between the Central Pacific TCG and us, which is the El Nino monsoon link. Okay? So these things have to be understood and to modeled if we are to really get an insight into the monsoon variability. Now I want to go back to history and wonder why it is that, you know, people are very selective in reading what earlier people suggested. Sikha mentioned yesterday that one of the geniuses who happened to be in our country was Blanford, and who became a meteorologist because he became sick as a geologist and couldn't carry on the field work with his brother. So, which is good for meteorology. And so I think it is he who first suggested 200 years after Halley that the monsoon is associated with the occurrence of a system which is seen over the equatorial Indian Ocean in the spring, and he didn't call it an ITCG. But I would like to read to you what he said, and I was just amazed at how perceptive he was. He says, during the spring months on the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea, the winds are light, frequently alternating with calms and somewhat variable. Then after a gap, he says, the change that ensues at the end of May or in June, when the surrounding seas are swept by a strong monsoon current and heavy and continued rain sets in on the coasts of India, is very marked and has long been recognized in popular language as the burst of the monsoon. The essential cause of the change appears to be that during the spring months, the sea winds which feed the storms of that season are the relatively damp but by no means saturated air of the surrounding seas, or if saturated, at least not so to any considerable vertical height above the sea surface. He is talking now of the spring. But in more southerly latitudes, says he, in the neighborhood of the equator is a belt of the atmosphere corresponding to the doldrums of the Atlantic, into which the southeast trades of the South Indian Ocean pour a steady supply of almost saturated air. He is talking of the equatorial trough or the ITCG, which is over the equatorial region in the spring. At all times of the year, more or less convection goes on in this belt, as proved by its raininess in all seasons, and consequently it affords a great reservoir of air, which up to an indefinite height above the sea surface borders on all at all times on a state of saturation. So then he says, now it appears to be the eventual rush of this air towards the region of low pressure developed over India gradually during the summer spring months that constitutes the burst of the monsoon. Once started, the energy of its movement is sustained by the condensation of its own copious vapor by the latent heat so set free. The energy of convection furnished by the heated atmosphere of the plains is competent only to keep up the feebler in-drought that obtains during the spring months. And indeed, even this in-drought is maintained partly by the moderate condensation of cumulus and local thunderstorms fed by the vapor it brings. These are the pre-monsoon showers he's talking about. The solar heat directly absorbed by the dry land atmosphere or taken up from the heated ground bears much the same relation to the general air movement as the pull of the trigger does to the propulsion of the rifle ball. It determines the disturbance of atmospheric equilibrium, but it does not furnish the energy of the resulting air stream. That energy is supplied in the latent heat of the indrawn vapor. So long as this supply is small and limited to the shallow stratum of air immediately fed by the evaporating surface beneath it, so long is the air movement feeble and interrupted. This is the spring situation. And it is only when the barotropic gradient from south to north has become sufficiently great to tap the great reservoir of latent energy supplied by the evaporation of the southeast trade zone, that the air current becomes strong and sustained, constituting the summer monsoon. Sustained too, long after the heated land surface has been in a great measure quenched and cooled by the rainfall. You know, it's such a beautiful description, I think, of what actually happens. Including he had a perception of how the deep clouds come from the south and how the earlier spring ones are isolated thunderstorms and so on. So more than 125 years ago, Blanford had first suggested that the Indian summer monsoon is associated with the appearance over the Indian region of the TCZ from the equatorial Indian Ocean. It is surprising that neither Simpson nor the following generations of meteorologists, which include Webster, Meal, and everybody, almost everybody who writes on the monsoon now, took note of this hypothesis by Blanford, which I believe was also conceived independently by Reel and Charney in the late 70s. Nor of Sikha Gadgil's proof of the validity of this hypothesis. See, the present generation of meteorologists has not accepted our proof either, that it is a TCZ. And to this day, we teach Halley's theory of the monsoon as a gigantic land-sea breeze. So I think something has to be done about this. But I think now, because of this, we have become richer, because we now can learn from the ITCZ elsewhere. We can take over whatever you people do in terms of the multi-scale interactions, bring in the complexity of the continent. But you know, we have a huge base to start from to understand monsoon variability. And to me, it seems to me a challenging problem for the kind of expertise we have in this room is to understand the interaction between the convective zones. Often it is initial condition dependent. You know, if one thing flares up, it will suppress things around it. How long will it be sustained? So on and so forth. I think that is the key problem of monsoon variability. Thank you.
So, first of all, I thought this was a... I just want to make sure I got the theme right. So, the active and break phases of the monsoon are effectively transitional phases between the ocean ITCZ and the continent ITCZ. Those related directly?
Yes, in two ways. Yes and no. Let me tell you. If we define active and break phases on the basis of rainfall us.
I know on the basis of rainfall, I was seeking a dynamic interpretation.
Yeah, let me complete. So let us define them on the basis of rainfall over the region, okay? Then there are two processes by which the monsoon revives from breaks. See, during intense breaks, the cloud band disappears, the surface trough moves to the Himalayan foothills, okay? Now, how does the monsoon revive? That's why it's called a break monsoon. You know, it's almost like pre-monsoon. How does the monsoon revive? It revives by two modes, okay? One is the mode from the oceanic ITC northward propagation, which has been overemphasized in the literature after our paper. They say all revival occurs from the south. That's not true. Half the revivals occur by genesis of synoptic scale systems over the Bay of Bengal, which is to say within that thing, and which move westward.
So you have enhanced easterly shear.
How those systems get generated, we don't have the last word yet, but some of them actually come from the West Pacific. Krish had shown that in an earlier study. So we have this system, planetary scale system, part of which is over us, but it is extending all the way. And often the West Pacific systems directly come to the headway, intensify over the warm ocean, and then move. So part of the revival of breaks also occurs from this. But we also showed in our paper that a vast majority of days on which the CTCZ is active is contributed by poleward propagating modes. So the ocean TCZ is a very critical component in maintaining the continental ITC.
Thank you very much.
Sure. Yes.
That's a monsoon tries to go to the dry mode, isn't it? The dry continental trough of the spring season, but something comes, and then it again the moisture. It's the moisture regime. the moisture that you have to provide, there is a still the basic hypothesis of differential heating is important. I would say that. But the extra thing is being produced by the moisture. Once the moisture comes, it becomes the heat trough becomes the moist trough, and the moist dynamics takes over and maintains it. The moisture is the key. How the moisture is brought is the first, the northward propagating mode, or why the monsoon disturb the low pressure areas moving in the near equatorial region, instead of moving westward, they start moving northwestward. The key lies there. That is the first major episode. And we want to know whether that episode is connected with the coming in of the MJO over the Arabian Sea. I believe that is connected to that. And I tried to show it also that it comes from the African side, you know, and it is not organized over Africa because it is a land region and all the convection is on the cluster scale, cloud cluster scale, not in the big ITCZ scale. But when it comes over the warm waters of the Arabian Sea, then it becomes very different. The character completely changes.
I'm pleased to say that, see, you thought that the mesoscale was a part of this, the mesoscale circulations. But I would like to ask about the synoptic scale. As far as the Bay of Bengal is concerned, does easterly wave propagation from the, you know, from the over Asia involve? Does it have anything to do with the revival of convection over the Bay of Bengal?
I don't know. You know,
it's in that kind of zone, you know, where you get east, could get
easterly. Could be. See, most of the theories of genesis, and I must say, most models don't get genesis right yet. Okay, so we can't even verify with GCM. Most of the theories of genesis came from the old era. So they had combined barotropic, baroclinic instability, and that is there every day, day after day. And of course, combined with the moist instability as well. And the concept is that part of the disturbances come from the West Pacific directly, yes. But there are some that get generated, several of them get generated over the warm waters of the bay. Okay? And the SST gradients are not that great over the bay. Everything is very, very warm, well above the threshold. So, I don't know, they believe that it is some combined barotropic, baroclinic, CISC, whatever you call it, instability which generates the disturbance. And once it's generated, movement of westward, I think, is easy too for the models, and one can see theories also as to why it happens. But I, you know, people stopped doing that kind of work, you know, about 20 years ago. Yes. You know, what leads to genesis of disturbances? And in the earlier work, you had linear stability theory, but all it showed was that the system is unstable. I have not seen any study in which they show some kind of a complex parameter. If that threshold is crossed, then the system gets generated. I would love to see that kind of theoretical work, but I have not seen it. So the genesis of systems, synoptic scale systems over our oceans, over tropical oceans perhaps, still remains an intriguing issue. Most of them are born in the ITCZ itself. Our northward propagation, you know, you have an ITCZ, the systems get born, and then it's the synoptic scale systems that move northward often. But I can't answer you.
I wish to make one small remark for thought-provoking. The monsoon, there are two types of monsoon breaks. One is short, small fluctuation of the ITC itself.
Those are weak spells, actually.
Isn't it?
They are wrong.
They are the
it's
weak spells, even
breaks.
The breaks, they are 3 days breaks are all due to that. And the system reverses on its own. That means 3 days, it tries to go there, then it reverts back to the normal position and it becomes the
moist. That's just the fluctuation.
The moist part. They are the fluctuation, internal fluctuation of the ITCZ. But there is something else occurs when the break is long.
And
in which the whole system,
then you
know,
get a
dies.
Heat low it, over India.
Yes.
Just like pre-monsoon.
Yes.
And that's when your northward propagation.
And you get the aerosols and whatnot, everything comes, there is a desert air, there is warm air. Why the monsoon in the middle of those drought years are warm? Because the air flow is entirely different. There is no ITC available there, isn't it? So if the ITC is not there, the number of those will not form. The disturbances will not. So the real thing is the dynamics of the monsoon trough, internal versus forced by from the equator or the MGO or whatever it is. So these are the two aspects which are quite different.
Okay, now let's break for tea. Before that, I think Amit has an... Oh, and let's thank Sulochana for a nice talk. Amit has a few announcements.
Just one. The banquet tonight will be in a hot restaurant that's a bit far away from here. The banquet is not on campus, so we'll need to arrange transport. So if you can sign up for those who are definitely going, that will be great. So that we'll have an idea of how many people are going from here or from nearby. I mean, if you're staying in a hotel or whatever nearby here, please sign up so that we'll arrange for transport accordingly. So that's what I wish. So I will pass it on, and then I will leave it here. And before lunch, please sign up so that, I mean, when we break for lunch, we will have an idea of how many people are going.